We are happy that you can worship with us today in person and on Zoom. A warm welcome is extended to any guests. And if you're new, please sign our guest book so we can get to know you better. It is the 19th Sunday after Pentecost. I am Jacquelin Lovell, your worship leader. Our minister is Reverend Nicholas Forrester. And we've been enjoying the music of our music minister, Christine Hanson. I would like to wish happy birthdays to Shaun Balasubramaniam and Marianne Clark on October 17th, and Ewan Carrion on October 22nd. And following that happy news and those celebrations, we have some sad news. It is with regret that we share the news of the passing of Mavis Grange, just short of her 99th birthday. Please keep her daughter Claudia and loved ones in your thoughts and prayers. Please stay for refreshments and fellowship following the service. Refreshments were thoughtfully prepared by Lily and Xavier Bala. Sign-up sheets are at the back of the sanctuary, and you're invited to sign up for worship leader, Sunday school helper, coffee hour. And we do need volunteers for worship leading. And the sign-up sheets are at the back. This week, the office hours are Wednesday and Friday, 10 to 2. And Susan works from home on Tuesday and Thursday. On Thursday coming, the United Church Women meeting is at 1 p.m. in the meeting room. And all women of the United Church are welcome. And new members are warmly welcomed. And we have our choir practice on Thursday, 7 to 9, and if you are interested, please come join us, have some time for singing and fun. There's a session called Healthy Aging following the service next Sunday between 11:30 and 12:30 with guest speaker Elsa Wu from Senior Persons Living Connected. And this talk will be in person and also via Zoom. There are posters in the narthex and also in the e-news. Please see the e-news or the bulletin for other upcoming events. Let us now prepare ourselves for worship as Margaret plays the chimes. Join me in the land acknowledgement. We acknowledge this land on which Ebenezer United Church serves our community. For thousands of years, this land has been on the traditional land of the Huron-Wendat, the Seneca, and the Mississaugas of the Credit River. Today, this meeting place is still the home to many indigenous people across Turtle Island, and we are grateful to have the opportunity to worship, pray, and practice our faith on this land. And let us affirm our faith by saying a new creed. We are not alone. We live in God's world.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
How beautiful is the word of the Lord. How wise are God's commandments.
Through the Lord's precepts, we gain understanding. Through God's wisdom, we find truth.
The Lord is our God. We are God's people. God's word lives within us, for it is written on our hearts.
We will exalt in God our salvation. We will rejoice in our Lord and worship our God.
Please be seated. The Christ candle is a sign to us that Jesus Christ has come into this world as the eternal light. The fellowship candles remind us that Jesus' people are the people of light in this world. As we light the Christ candle, let us hear the voice of Jesus say, "I am the light of the world." And as we light the fellowship candles, let us also hear the voice of Jesus say, "You are the light of the world." Thank you, Saviour. Let us now sing "Praise to the Lord the Almighty," Voices United 220.
Thank you.
God of our days and our nights, Lord of our valleys and our mountains, we come into your sanctuary and into your presence at this time to worship you, to give you the praise that you deserve, and to show you the love that we have for you because of who you are. We come to learn from you what you would have us do and be. Grant that this may be the time of prayer, communion, holy thought, and meditation. Grant, too, that we may rejoice no matter what the circumstances in our lives are right now and will be. Developing a stronger faith in you, we ask it in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we continue in prayer as we confess our sins to Almighty God. Almighty and most merciful God, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep.
We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws.
We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is nothing good in us. O Lord, have mercy upon us, and forgive our every sin. Spare us in your mercy, as we are content. Restore us in your grace, according to your promises declared through Jesus Christ our Lord. And grant that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of your holy name. Through Christ we pray. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance. I will put my law within them, and I will write it in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people, declares the Lord. I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. To all who turn to the Lord, then, he says, your sins are forgiven. He also says, follow me. Thanks be to God. The Lord's Prayer.
Thank you. seated. I invite the children to come to the front of the side. Good morning. Let's try that one more time. I don't think you're awake. Good morning.
Good morning.
We're going to try it one more time. Good morning.
Good morning.
I can come to care for that, right? How are you doing today? Good? You're doing good? Perfect. I'm glad to hear that. How are you guys doing today?
Good.
Good. Blessed. Feeling blessed. I'm good. Feeling well. Perfect. It's good to see you all. It's good to be here one more time, having this wonderful opportunity to be in church. We have been sort of off being able to do that the way we have been accustomed to because of the pandemic, but thankfully we are here and we can do this. Now, I have a challenge for somebody. Is there anyone here who would like to take on a challenge? I can come to Nathan for that. You can stand up. You want to take on the challenge as well?
Yes,
that's the trick. That's the trick. All right, so you're going to stand right here. Want to try this as well, Lily? Want to try it? No? Okay. You can stand. Stand beside Nathan. You learn about it. All right. Now, this is the challenge. I want to see who can stand on one leg the longest. After two, one, two. Let's see who falls first. Okay, I'm sweating. Okay, good job. You can sit down. Are you okay? Okay, it's okay, it's all right. Okay, Nathan. That's okay. Okay, thank you, Lily. All right, everybody sit down right here. I never expected her to fall. I would have caught her. I thought it was one of her little tricks that she usually pulls on me. It's okay, sweetheart. You'll be fine. Sort of messes with my mojo now. It's not nice to see your kid crying. All right, so what I wanted you to do that challenge this morning is to see who would give up first, right? Is to see who would give up first and to ask, why do you think that you stood so long, Nathan? Why do you think that you were able to stand on one leg so long? Not sure. What about you, Lily? You were balanced. Okay. I know that for me, because of the challenge, it would be because I would not want to lose. Is there anybody inside here that's competitive? Any competitive person? Anybody who doesn't like to lose, can't stand losing? I don't like losing. It's not a good feeling. I always want to win. Now, there is a story in the scriptures about a woman who was trying to get a king, an important person, of course, to give her something. But the king would not give her any attention whatsoever. But she kept going back again and again and again. She just would not give up because she wanted to win. She wanted to win. And it didn't matter what the king said to her, it didn't matter what happened. When she went in front of the king, she just kept going back. Because she didn't want to lose, she wanted to win. And eventually, do you know what happened? Anyone guess what happened? The king listened, the king gave up. It wasn't the woman who gave up, but the king gave up. The king listened and gave her exactly what she wanted. But the king said to himself, lest she wears me out by her constant coming back. I would just give her exactly what she was. You know, sometimes in life, we just have to learn to hold on. Even in the most difficult situations and circumstances, even when it's hard, even when it's painful. And if we had time, it perhaps would have caused the challenge to go on a little longer. And perhaps if Gabriel had not fallen, I'd have caused the challenge to go on a little bit longer. Just so that you could perhaps feel some physical challenge to doing what you were doing. Physical challenge, I mean like pain. Not pain in a mean way, but just the difficulty of being able to stand on one leg for a long period of time. And because it's a challenge, and you know that you don't want to lose, you perhaps would have hung in there because you didn't want to give up. I want to challenge all of us today that no matter what we do or face in this life, never, ever give up. Even when we don't know what's going on or what is going to happen, never, ever give up. Always fight on. And even if we should fall, like Gabriel fell, sometimes we have to get right back up and do it again. So we might not know the math in school, but we keep trying and trying until we get it. We might not know a particular word when we're reading, but we keep trying and trying until we get it. We might not know how to spell a few words, but we keep trying and trying until we get it. Never, ever give up. No matter how hard, no matter how difficult, always learn to be persistent and to fight on. I want to invite you to stand, and we're going to say prayer. Bow your heads with me and let us pray. Say after me, dear Lord Jesus, thank you for today. Thank you for life. Help me to never give up. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Inspiring God, you have given us the gift of Scripture to equip us to live faithfully in the world. Open us to hear your word for today, whether it challenges or comforts us, so that we may live more faithfully as we follow Jesus, your living word, in whose glorious and powerful name we pray. Amen.
Our first scripture reading is from the Old Testament, Jeremiah chapter 31, reading verses 27 to 34. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will plant the kingdoms of Israel and Judah with the offspring of people and of animals, just as I watched over them to uproot and tear down, and to overthrow, destroy, and bring disaster. So I will watch over them to build and to plant, declares the Lord. In those days, people will no longer say, the parents have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. Instead, everyone will die for their own sin, whoever eats sour grapes. Their own teeth will be set on edge. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors, when I took them by the hand and led them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is a covenant I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, know the Lord, because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wickedness and remember their sins no more. The New Testament reading is from Luke chapter 18, reading verses 1 to 8. Then Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. He said, in a certain town there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared about what people thought. And there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with the plea, grant me justice against my adversary. For some time he refused, but finally he said to himself, even though I don't fear God or care what people think, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will see that she gets justice, so that she won't eventually come and attack me. And the Lord said, listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, he will see that they get justice and quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Here's a background to our anthem this morning. The week's anthem, this week's anthem is a meditative setting on all three verses of the hymn, Breathe on Me, Breath of God, by Edwin Hatch, a British theologian and academic. Hatch lived and worked in Canada for most of his career as a professor of classics at Trinity College at the University of Toronto, and as professor of classics at Morin College in Quebec City. The hymn, Anthem, Breathe on Me, Breath of God.
Thank you.
Today, I wish to reflect on the theme, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. I did before a sermon where I focused a little bit on prayer and what it is. There I mentioned that prayer is relationship. Prayer is that moment of, or the life of communion that we have with God. Prayer is that fellowship that we share with God. Today's text is one where Jesus challenges and charges his disciples. According to the NIV, that they should always pray and never give up. They should always pray and never give up. And this in the face of the coming of the kingdom of God and the coming of the end of time. This in the context of what Jesus knew the disciples were about to endure with his departure being imminent. It would have been easy for the disciples after Jesus' death to have gone back to their life that they knew before Jesus came into their lives, disrupted their lives, turned their lives upside down, caused them to be experiencing things that they never experienced before in a negative and in an adverse way. Their lives were being threatened by those who wanted to maintain the status quo and the establishment. We know of the stories of how some of these disciples met their demise in the most brutal, barbaric, and gruesome ways. Yet, facing all these daunting prospects, Jesus would challenge his disciples to pray and not to give up. And so Jesus tells the story about this importunate widow, this persistent widow, this person who would just not relent, who would just not give up. And how she went against the grain because she risked so much by presenting herself before this judge as frequently or as often as she did, seeking what she claimed was justice. Another version says that it was a king that she kept presenting herself before. The consequences could have been dire. But that was not what was on the widow's mind. What was on the widow's mind was getting justice. What was on the widow's mind was having her request answered. What was on the widow's mind was resolving a challenge, a problem, a terrible situation that she had to endure. And she was determined that she was going to be relentless in her pursuit of what she desired. Now I can think of several other characters in the scripture that can relate to this woman. Perhaps it comes to mind about a woman with the issue of blood who suffered that hemorrhaging for 12 long years, we are told. And then one day she heard that Jesus was in town, and she decided that she was going to meet him, for she was going to get her deliverance and her healing on that day. She risked everything because she should not have been in public. A woman in a situation like that was considered unclean and should not have been in the company of others. I can imagine her going through the crowd, bustling, trying to get to Jesus. Maybe she faced ridicule as somebody recognized her, wondering what was she doing in the public square, knowing what the custom was. I can't imagine others pushing her out of the way and saying to her that this is not a place for you. Go back to where you're supposed to be. But she was relentless, just like this widow. She was determined that she was going to get her healing and her deliverance, and absolutely nothing was going to get in her way. Absolutely nothing was going to stop her. And so she persevered. And she reached the place where she got exactly what she came to Jesus for. Touched the hem of his garment, for that's what she said. If I could but touch the hem of his garment, I will be made whole. We're told that Jesus stopped and looked around and said and asked the question, who touched me? One of his disciples was so perplexed, perhaps even annoyed, saying, responding to Jesus with a retort, do you not see how many persons are rubbing up against you, brushing up against you, yet you ask such a silly question, who touched you? We're all touching you. But he didn't understand the question that Jesus asked. For the touch that Jesus spoke of was not the ordinary physical touch, but it was a touch of faith. It was a touch of supernatural power. So here we are with this text, wrestling with what Jesus has to say to us. And I use the word wrestling because prayer is not something that is high on many of our agendas as Christians. As a matter of fact, the prayer meeting in the church is usually the event that is least supported by the members of the church. Now, I don't know what happens here yet at Ebenezer, for I'm just starting out. I guess I will see what happens when we get to that place. But we struggle in this spiritual discipline. We really wrestle in this spiritual discipline. For one writer says, those who pray are like a city gutted by fire. He says that to say to us that prayer exacts from us an awful cost. Prayer takes a lot. We saw that in Jesus' example of prayer. And no place typified it more than that time when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane and he prayed, and Luke says, until his sweat were like great drops of blood. I can just imagine the agony that Jesus was in as he prayed. To be in such agony that you are sweating. But not only that you were sweating, but that your sweat was not normal sweat, so to speak. It tells me that Jesus was exerting himself. It tells me that Jesus was giving of himself. It tells me that Jesus was exercising in this spiritual discipline. Now, can you imagine yourself praying until you sweat?
let alone sweating until your sweat doesn't appear to be normal. So Jesus admonishes us to pray. We don't only find it here in Luke chapter 18, but we also find it in Matthew's Gospel chapter 7, verses 7 to 11, in John's Gospel chapter 15, in Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6. In John's Gospel chapter 15 and verse 5. These texts, they show us that Jesus, what Jesus meant prayer to be. From this then, it is quite possible that we grieve Jesus when we neglect or refuse to pray. Neglect of prayer or refusal to pray is to cut off fellowship with Christ. For if indeed prayer is relationship, if indeed prayer is communion, if indeed prayer is fellowship, then when I refuse to pray, it means that I refuse in relationship with Christ. It means I refuse in fellowship with Christ. It means I refuse in communion with Christ. It means I have cut myself off from my Lord. John's Gospel chapter 15 tells us what happens to the believer when he or she fails to abide in Christ. When our prayer lives are non-existent, we wander aimlessly in spiritual distress, as the person who goes into medical distress because of a lack of some vital function in our spiritual being. When our prayer lives are non-existent, we become spiritual cripples and dwarves, spiritually starved and emaciated, with not even enough strength to stand on our own feet in the face of the challenges to live the Christian life. So we're harkened back to this importunate widow. She recognized the need to persevere in her quest. Maybe what her situation was, the scripture does not tell us, is one that was directly tied to her quality of life. Maybe it was tied to her standard of living. Maybe it was tied to some legal right that she had. Whatever it was, we do not know. But it was so important to her that she recognized that she had to persevere no matter the cost. The question begs then for us, why do we as Christians so often fail so miserably in prayer? And this is an assumption that I make based on the outcomes that we observe in and around the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ all across the world. We will all admit, both to ourselves and to others, without any question, that to pray is difficult for all of us, as I mentioned before. I don't know about you, but yes, I find prayer to be difficult. Sometimes you never really start to feel tired until you get down on your knees and you start to pray. And then the yawns start coming out. And before the prayer can be finished, you realize that you have dozed off for a few moments, and you have to bring yourself back to that state of alertness in prayer. You could be there sitting on your couch or your sofa watching television all night, but as soon as you go to prayer, instead of watching TV on another night, you find that you're not feeling up to it. You find that you're falling asleep. You find that you're feeling so tired. This difficulty lies in the very act of praying itself. To pray, really to pray, is what is difficult for us. It feels like too much of an effort. I can never understand it though. Because prayer is relationship. And when you're in relationship, you want to be in constant contact with the other person in that relationship. You're excited about having conversation. You're excited about sharing exchanges. You're excited about simply being in the presence of that person. You want to hear from that person. You want that person to hear from you. The natural person feels that prayer is too much of an effort. That according to 1 Corinthians 2:14 and Romans chapter 8 and verse 7. The natural person does pray, but usually on occasion of hardship. Prayer for the natural person is not fellowship. The natural person sees prayer as a burdensome task. Too much of a challenge. Such a person does not pray out of a desire, but rather out of a sense of duty. He or she feels under some kind of spiritual compulsion to pray. Usually this compulsion is tied to a fear of retribution from God. For us believers, it was much easier when we just got saved, but got more and more difficult as time wore on. How ironic. You would think that practice makes perfect. You would think that when you started running, it was difficult at first, but after you did a few laps for a few weeks, it got easier and easier and easier. You would suppose that one should get better at something after much practice, so much so that the activity can be performed without thought, as though an autopilot. The more of a burden that prayer becomes, is the more it is neglected and even rejected. What happens when we neglect prayer? Now bear in mind Jesus' words to the disciples, you should always pray and never give up. Here is what happens when we neglect prayer. Our minds become worldly. We feel alienated, separated, detached from God. We start to have less and less things to pray about. We develop an unwilling spirit which always finds pretexts for what we might call red herrings and excuses for having neglected prayer. Our inner lives begin to weaken. We become almost immune, if not immune, totally to godly sorrow, holy conviction, contrition, brokenness that comes from living in sin. Our spiritual vision becomes blurred or veiled, and we can scarcely distinguish between holiness and sinfulness. Right becomes wrong, and wrong becomes right, and we make excuses for and rationalize the wrong. We resist sin in no different a manner than the world does. We become nonchalant concerning the state and the end of our souls. But let's hear again the words of Jesus. You should always pray and never give up. Two things that we take away from what Jesus says then, that we should always practice prayer. That we should always persevere in prayer. I mentioned earlier on the quote from one author who says that we who grow towards prayer or praying are like a city that we are gutted by fire. The struggle towards the cause of God has exacted such an awful cost from us. Those who pray do so not because they believe certain intellectual propositions about the value of prayer, but simply because the struggle to be human and to be Christian in the face of superhuman and supernatural powers requires it. The act of praying itself is itself one of the indispensable means by which we engage the powers of this world. It is not merely a religious practice externally imposed, but an existential struggle against the impossible, against an anti-human collective atmosphere, against images of worth and value that stunt and wither all human life. It is a spiritual power, spiritually discerned and spiritually exercised. What does this mean then for us as the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ? Well, there must be a reason that Jesus says that we should always pray and we should never give up. We should always pray and never give up because, as Walter Wink says, this is not some mere intellectual exercise. This is not some mere religious practice. But it is, in fact, an existential struggle against everything that comes against not just the Church, but against us as human beings. We look around us and we see all kinds of things happening that causes the soul to be depressed, that causes the soul to be sad. Jesus says to us that our way out of this, our way through this, our way to survive this, our way to overcome this is through prayer. It's through remaining connected with God. It's through remaining sheltered under the wings of the living God. It is, therefore, a challenge to all of us to hear these words of Jesus. We know not why these words come in this moment, at this point in time. But we know that it comes to us because Jesus wants us to be ready. Jesus wants us to be in relationship with Him. Jesus wants us to be in communion with Him. Jesus wants us to be in fellowship with Him. For with Jesus and in Jesus, everything is okay. In the name of God who is Father, God who is Son, and God who is Spirit. Amen. Our hymn of reflection for today, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. Thank you. thanksgiving, intercession, and supplication. God of our past, present, and future, our healing and hope, we come before you with grateful hearts, trusting that you walk with us through all the times of our lives. Thank you that you never give up on us, even when we are tempted to give up on you.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
We pray today for those who face danger and despair in these times. We remember before you those living with violence, with hunger that never ends, those caught up in unrest and violence, and all those whose lives are caught up in forces beyond their control. We pray for all those working to relieve suffering in these places, and for those who work to bring justice and peace.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
We pray for all those facing fear or frustration, wrestling with sorrow or discouragement in any area of their lives. We remember before you those living with illness or pain, those bearing up with chronic conditions or disability, those who know the grief and change of bereavement. We pray for all those who work to bring healing and comfort and agencies which offer support and care to those who suffer.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
We pray for all who feel helpless or hopeless in this present time. We remember before you those around us facing unemployment, struggling to make ends meet, those caught up in the pain of misunderstanding or broken relationships, and those working through situations of conflict at home or at work. We pray for all who offer guidance and support in the midst of such difficulties, and for those who lend skills in reconciliation or mediation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Like the widow at the judge's bench, our God persists in inviting us to be generous and respond to needs we might think are beyond us. Trust that God will bless what we offer and so can do surprising things with us and for us, our tithes and offerings. Generous and benevolent God, we have only because you give to us unconditionally. We can claim nothing of our own merit, for everything we have is a trust from you. Today, therefore, we return to you our tithes, offerings, and gifts. Accept, we pray, and bless these tithes, offerings, and gifts to your use in your kingdom. Grant us the wisdom to administer these gifts for your glory, honor, and praise. In the name of Jesus, our Savior and Lord, we pray. Amen. Please be seated, everyone.
And now our prayers for the people. O Lord, today we pray for all those in need, whether in body, mind, or spirit. Let your healing light and your presence will bring comfort and peace. Today we lift up before you Roy Dixon, Angie Fix, Michelle Gillette, Dorothy Grant, Joan and Clyde's friends, David and Donnelly Gollison, Phyllis Harvey's husband, Cyril, Doug's sister, Jackie, Doug's friend, Carol, and her brother, Tanya's cousin, Edwin, and friend, Jenna, Sarah's father-in-law, Pavlos, and his wife, Flora, Diane's friend, Tokiko, Joseph, Selim's, Mary's brother, Basil, and sister, Kathy, Connie's friend, Elaine Lieber, and her daughter, Andrea. We pray for Chris and her entire family. We pray for Claudia and the entire family and all the loved ones of Mavis Grange as they grieve her passing. Be with them in this moment. And we lift up all those who we name in silence before you. O God of grace, hear our prayer and in your love answer. Amen. Our closing hymn for today, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Benediction. In the power of the Holy Spirit, we now go forth into the world to fulfill our calling as a people of God, the body of Christ. Go in peace. and the blessing of Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life, abide with and within you both now and always. Go with God, my friends. Amen.